I will never play League of Legends. I don't find MOBAs to be fun, and from the outside looking in, it just seems that anyone who does play it ends up just having a terrible time from the toxicity to the downright rage. So you can trust me to be unbiased when I say that Arcane is absolutely amazing. When I first heard of the series, it was recommended to me by friends who of course played League of Legends as a quote, really good video game adaptation. Since I actually care about my mental well-being, I brushed it aside because I was pretty sure that they were being biased considering they were League fans. Video game adaptations have been notoriously bad, so why should this one be any different? As a professional League of Legends hater, I was highly skeptical of the series and thought that fans were blinded by their biased love of the game. During the holidays, I had nothing to watch and was morbidly curious by all the praise it was getting, even by non-League fans. I watched the first episode, thought it was pretty good with great animation, and was going to continue it the next day. Little did I know that when I reached the end of episode 3, I was completely hooked and had to finish it that day. Arcane is a work of art. From the captivating story, the tragic characters, and stunning animation, comes a series that delivers an emotional and truly cinematic experience. Arcane is a series that has a multitude of different messages and themes, ranging from the greed of capitalism to the dangers of new technology. It handles its ideas with a grounded and deeply contemplative tone that never feels preachy or overbearing. It's given the weight and seriousness it deserves, but never outright points to one correct answer. Arcane is about duality and the morally gray perspectives that come from both sides. From the dichotomy of Piltover and the Undercity, the internal struggle of Powder and Jinx, to the father and daughter relationships of Vi and Vander and the twisted version of it, Jinx and Silco. This duality can be found everywhere throughout the series. However, I think at its core, Arcane is a personal story of the two sisters and the inevitable tragedy that separates them. Today, I want to talk about my favorite aspects of the series being the relationship of the two sisters, Vi and Powder, and what made their dynamic so captivating yet heartbreaking by the end. Arcane begins with a young Vi and Powder walking down a blood-painted bridge that sets the initial tone of the series. But what's more impressive is the deep red hue surrounding the girls, telling us that this is a world filled with war, violence, and dread. Piltover is a high-class steampunk city where people get to live luscious and comfortable lives. It's also a city filled with wondrous opportunities for the greatest of minds, hence why it's dubbed the City of Progress. The first introduction of Piltover is a beautifully scenic shot that captures the technologically advanced, high-class city with warm and vibrant colors that feel inviting to anyone who sets foot. The Undercity, on the other hand, looks and feels like a totally different place and is quite the opposite of Piltover. It's dark, drab, and surrounded by this green hue, almost as if it's signaling that it's a toxic place. The aesthetic it gives off is a dystopian cyberpunk underground hideout run by criminals in a lawless land. It feels both like the ghetto and dark market of the world it's set in, where almost anything goes and people will have to fight for scraps and fend for themselves. Vander is early on introduced as the older and more experienced father figure for Vi and the gang. He knows what road violence and uprising against Piltover's enforcers will lead to, the death and destruction for both sides. Is it really worth sacrificing the people you love in order just to get a chance at freedom from oppression? Vander doesn't think so because he already holds blood on his hands. Vi and Powder's parents went into battle with him but didn't come out the other side. Vander is the leader of the people in the Undercity and has cultivated a community where people trust him and thereby each other. He's a respected man who holds high morals of never putting anything above the safety of his people, even if it means worse later on.
You've got a good heart. Don't ever lose it, no matter how the world tries to break you.
Vi is a bold, hot-headed teenager who's ready to prove herself useful to Vander and holds deep ambitions to change the world she currently lives in. While she may have the courage, strength, and willpower necessary to make an actual difference, she doesn't have the experience nor wisdom that Vander has. Vi holds a deep-seated resentment for the people of Piltover, and it's completely understandable. In her eyes, Piltover is a place filled with overabundance, with people living cushy lives being oblivious to the fact that there's such a class diversity between them. The people of the top side don't care about anything else apart from their own growth and only see the Undercity as a problem and not a place that needs fixing, rebuilding, or better conditions for the people less fortunate. From the moment she was born, Vi grew up in the Undercity always believing that she was lesser than those born in Piltover. For them, the Undercity was always seen as a foul place where criminals and crime syndicates run free. There were no good people to be found in such a vile place. While from Vi's perspective, Piltover is only a place where the rich and wealthy reside. They only care about power and their own greed, a city of progress where they pretend to govern the people for their best interests, yet lack the empathy to help those in need in the Undercity. It's this cycle of hatred for one another and classism that leads to the rising tension between the enforcers and the people of the Undercity. Vi wants to fight for her freedom. She's tired of having her family and friends live off the scraps and leftovers from Piltover. She wants Powder to live in a world where she's finally free from the shackles of those who oppress them. It's a burning desire to be free, and Vi will more than willingly give everything she has to achieve it. However, Vander shows her what violence and uprising will lead to, as he's already been down this road. Being an older and more experienced father figure, Vander was just like Vi when he was younger. He saw himself in her and could understand the pent-up rage and frustration she holds for the people in Piltover. When he fought on the bridge many years ago, he thought what he was doing was the right thing. He believed that his fight for freedom was going to liberate them, but what he didn't account for was the sacrifice he needed to pay for that freedom. He wasn't prepared to lose the lives of those closest to him, friends, family, and children. This was the price he was not willing to pay. And through his experience, he teaches Vi what path her violence will ultimately lead to.
You know, Powder, what makes you different makes you strong. Always remember that, okay?
Powder is a young, innocent girl living in a world that would absolutely eat her alive if it weren't for the kindness and compassion of Vander and Vi. She's constantly being put down by Milo because her actions and her inability always causes trouble for the group. From episode 1, you can see that she's desperate for the approval of her parental figures and family, and every time she's belittled by others, this affects her mentality greatly, even if it's not outwardly seen. It's a constant build-up until it all comes to a sudden climax. Vi and Powder's relationship is the crux of the series. Powder looks up to Vi as a guiding light for her life, but also seeks her love and approval. And for Vi, she wants to protect the childlike innocence of Powder from the horrors of the outside world. She wants her to grow into her own person one day, where Powder can show the world just how much she can do. The two girls hold a deep and genuine sister-like bond as they're practically family to each other. Vi is the only one in the group who can see the potential in Powder, where everyone else sees her as a burden, and the conversation at the rooftop of episode 1 cements why Powder later wants to be respected by those around her because it was instilled to her by Vi. Powder may not have the strong physical capabilities like the others in the group, but from a young age she has shown talent in working with homemade gadgets. This is something that Milo doesn't see the potential in, but at the arcade, Powder shows off her incredible accuracy in the shooting range. This shows us that Powder does indeed have hidden talents that are not yet fully realized or appreciated, but one day they will be. During the rescue mission for Vander, Vi stops Powder from coming with the group because she's a person who Vi doesn't want to lose. Powder still insists that she wants to help because families always stick together, but Vi says the one thing that deeply hurts her: you're not ready. For Vi, it doesn't seem like anything big, as she's just trying to protect Powder from the coming violence and danger when confronting Silco. But for Powder herself, it's a rejection of who she is as a person. Powder didn't really care for the conflict that was going on between the Undercity and Piltover. She was much more concerned in being a person who could be loved and valued by the others in her family. Every time that a mission went wrong because of her, she would lose confidence in herself, believing that she was a burden to those around her. And those thoughts kept manifesting inside of her to the point where her sense of self-worth was shown by the validation of others rather than her own ability or perception of herself. It was to the point where she craved that love and validation from others that made her own identity become without it, she was just a small and lonely girl, powerless to do anything. So when Vi leaves her all alone in the hideout, she has a massive breakdown because she feels as if she's lost the love of someone close to her and will be all alone. When I first saw this moment, I thought it was a bit of an overreaction considering the character animation showed Powder screaming, wailing, and crying with such intensity. But after knowing what she has been through, it accentuates the type of mindset she has. Powder is just a little girl with deep insecurities about herself that she doesn't want to be alone. It's what then makes the end of episode 3 so tragic and devastating. Powder wants to be seen as useful to the group and so goes against Vi's words. She combines her homemade gadgets with the stolen Hextech crystals and sets them off because she believes that it will help them escape. But things go horribly wrong. The explosion causes a chain reaction that injures both sides and ultimately kills Milo and Clagger in the crossfire. The shockwave even knocks Powder off the edge of the roof, and there's an absolutely haunting shot where she's slowly falling, but all the while smiling because she truly believes she did the right thing. When all the dust has settled and Powder confronts Vi that this was all her doing, Vi understandably loses control of her emotions. Her friends and family are dead, and it was all because Powder did something when she was told to stay put. Vi, in all her anger and grief, hits Powder and calls her Jinx, just like Milo had all this time. She leaves Powder to cool off her emotions, but is unable to get back to her when Silco arrives. From Powder's point of view, she was just doing what she thought was going to help the group. She didn't understand how dangerous the crystals were and the consequences her actions would lead to. She's just a child, and in her own words, she only wanted to help. When Vi leaves her, she's at her absolute lowest point. Powder is now all alone, and the family she once had is no more. When Silco appears in front of her, she embraces him because she thinks she has no one left. Powder is a lonely and insecure little girl that needs the love and affection of others because it's the only way it can validate her own existence and identity. All she ever wanted in life was to be loved and valued by the people around her, yet the actions she took in order to obtain her personal needs led to the death and destruction of everything she wanted, a loving family. Powder says she has no sister anymore, and Silco embraces her back as he says the words, "It's okay, we'll show them. We will show them all." And the shot where it only shows Powder's intense gaze speaks so much emotion of her character without any words. What I personally took from it was the pain and anger from the portrayal of her sister, the desire to be respected by the whole world and to prove everyone wrong about her. The end of episode 3 is the first tragedy of Arcane. It's also the catalyst that transforms Powder, the small, insecure, and powerless little girl at the start of the series, into Jinx. Watching this for the first time without any prior knowledge of League of Legends lore, I was awestruck because I had no idea who Jinx even was, and witnessing the origin story from Powder was truly devastating. This was the episode where I'm sure I and many other people finally realized that Arcane wasn't just your typical video game adaptation. This was masterful storytelling from something I never would have in a million years expected from. This was cinema. Everything from the dark tone, the tragic characters, the stunning cinematography, the beautiful animation, and somber music was just executed so perfectly. It was at this point in the series where I was finally hooked and couldn't stop watching. The first time we meet Jinx, she's faster, stronger, and smarter than Powder ever was. She easily dispatches a pack of firelights, but after mistaking one of the girls with her sister Vi, we can see that deep down she hasn't changed all that much. Jinx suffers from delusions of her past trauma with Vi and her previous family. She now works under Silco as he sees her as a daughter he took in when no one else wanted her. When a job goes wrong, Silco gives her a break, which she takes personally as him seeing her as a weak person. Despite being able to do so many things now, Jinx deep down is still the same person she was years ago. A little girl who holds insecurities about herself that she needs the validation of others to feel like her own person. In the years that have passed, Piltover has become an even greater city of technological advancements thanks to the power of Hextech. It's become the center of a world hub with supersonic travel using airships, bigger buildings, and improvements with the quality of life. Caitlin is the daughter of a counselor and has enlisted to become an enforcer within Piltover. Being born from a royal family, her mother doesn't want her to be in dangerous situations, and so she gets stationed in the most safest of areas, far from any real threats or danger. But Caitlin doesn't want special treatment just because because she was born from royalty. She's a strong and independent woman who wants to uphold integrity and justice in the world. Even if she is seen differently by her peers, she didn't ask to be treated this way. Caitlyn upholds her own unwavering standards and morals as she wants to make the world a better place, even if she is a bit naive and privileged when compared to the people in the Undercity. When Vi and Caitlyn meet each other for the first time, their initial interaction with each other is representative of not only the traits they despise from one another, but the classism and prejudice that both sides have against one another. Vi only sees Caitlyn as a power-corrupt officer who only cares about their own selfish desires without care or regard for the people in the Undercity, while for Caitlyn, she sees Vi as a ruthless and untrustworthy criminal who will lie and betray anyone, having no moral integrity for herself. It's a microcosm for the whole scope of the city, and this dichotomy is even more apparent as their relationship continues forward. The way they both fight is also representative from the cities they come from. Vi's movement and actions are much more freestyle, impulsive, and chaotic, compared to Caitlyn, where her style is the opposite, more refined, calculated, and has a set order to it. As the two spend increasing time together, Vi and Caitlyn find common ground with each other, where they start letting down their personal walls. Vi shows her what the Undercity is really like. Citizens are living in fear and poverty, where crime lords like Silco run rampant, and there's no one to stop them. In return, Caitlyn's own moral integrity and empathy teaches Vi that not all topsiders are people who selfishly think of themselves. Vi and Caitlyn make a great team together, as they both have experienced lives in the cities they both resented. Both their personalities and dynamics bounce off extremely well with each other. Vi is much more brash and impulsive, believing that it's better to act first and to talk later, while on the other hand, Caitlyn's methods are much more controlled and diplomatic, only resulting to violence when she needs to. They both represent their own city's counterpart, and the mix and matching of their relationship just shows us that it's possible for the two people who grew up in opposite backgrounds having a shared understanding of one another. It's the first step in healing the city and reuniting the citizens together, but as they talk in the council, it becomes clear that the higher-ups only care about their own selfish needs and not the city as a whole. During the years that have passed, Silco has wanted Jinx to let go of the past and let Powder die once and for all. But Jinx still remembers and cherishes the sisterly bond she had with Vi, and after the time skip where they finally meet each other for the first time in years, they both start to cry tears of joy. It's an emotional moment for both of them, as Jinx was led to believe that her sister had left for good. Vi wants nothing more than to have her sister back and clear up the misunderstanding she had in the past. But as Caitlyn and the Firelight show up, Jinx's delusions and insecurities get the better of her. In her mind, Jinx starts to believe the lies that she was told about her sister were all true, that she abandoned her, left her all alone, that Vi didn't care about her anymore. When she sees that Vi is working together with Caitlyn, her paranoia and jealousy leads her to be even more insecure about herself. This turns into an all-out battle with the Firelights, where Caitlyn and Vi are kidnapped and Jinx is left all alone once again. It's truly devastating to see a once good-hearted character who wanted nothing more than the love and validation of those around her become such an unstable and deranged person. But what makes it truly tragic is that she still holds memories of who she once was. Powder, the sweet, innocent little girl at the beginning of the series, is still somewhere inside Jinx, fighting to have her sister back. However, the world and the circumstances around her have not been kind. Jinx is the personification of everything that Powder wanted to be in her fantasies. A strong, dependable, and cunning girl who everyone either fears or respects, and the latter is the most important, as Vi instilled that dream inside of Powder when they were just kids, that people, the city, everyone will respect them one day. Jinx chases that dream no matter the cost, and it's because of her ruthless actions and lack of empathy for others why her character is so deeply flawed, yet we want to root for her to become the person she once was. This tug-of-war battle of the good and bad side, the internal struggle that she has with herself, Powder versus Jinx, it's a conflict that is so very personal for our characters that there is no right or wrong answer. Powder was a sweet and innocent child, but Jinx is a ruthless and crazed person who has done some very terrible things, and the obvious question starts to arise. Can she redeem herself? Is she even allowed to at this point? We know the girl that she once was, and Powder is still somewhere inside of her, yet Jinx has been enabled and supported for so long by Silco. Every time anything went wrong and it was Powder's fault, everyone would call her a Jinx. Yet now, years later, when she has finally become Jinx, Vi is the only person who wants to call her Powder again. Vi still believes that somewhere deep inside Jinx, her little sister that she had cared for so many years still exists, and she's not wrong. Vi desperately wants to fix her past mistake of leaving Powder all alone to fend for herself. But as Silco's influence has grown ever larger behind Jinx, the girl she once was seems so far out of reach. Vi feels guilty for not being there for so many years and wants to make things right again, but Jinx is unstable and it's only a matter of time before she's pushed over the edge and is too far gone.
Are we still sisters? Nothing is ever going to change that.
Episode 9, the final episode of Arcane, is the culmination of not just where the series will head moving forward, it's the end of some characters and their relationships with each other. Silco is given a deal by Jace that would end Piltover's reign of the Undercity and make its own independency, but he has to give up Jinx in doing so. In the past, Silco would not have given it a second thought if it meant that the nation of Zaun could finally be respected as he had always dreamt of. He wouldn't have bat an eye in sacrificing anything and anyone just to get his way. Yet now he's at an impasse because he's developed such a strong bond and connection to Jinx, raising her as his own daughter. I don't think that was the plan initially, but over time, it's obvious that he saw a lot of himself in her, where both of them would do anything to garner the respect they had always sought for and deserved. They both had been betrayed by the people closest to them and left alone to survive in this cruel world, and it's over time that Silco had developed a familial love for Jinx that he wouldn't want to sacrifice her for anything. In his own words, she's perfect. When he sits down by the statue of his brother Vander, Silco finally understood what it was like to have something to lose in his quest for victory, just like Vander did so many years ago. It turns out that he and Vander weren't so different after all. The dinner party scene, which takes up half of the episode's runtime, is given the intensity and gravitas that it deserves. This was all leading towards the end of Powder and Jinx's identity crisis, as well as the fate of Piltover. Vi is given a choice to shoot Caitlyn so that she can have her sister back, but she can't. After spending all that time together with Caitlyn, she finally understood that not all topsiders were bad people. Vi would rather leave this place altogether and just go off with her sister, never looking back. It's something that I believe she would actually do, because after being stuck in prison, all she's ever cared about was getting back to Powder and protecting her like she had promised to Vander. She knows that deep down inside, Powder still exists somewhere, and if she could fulfill her promise, everything would be back to normal. But that's just it. Jinx can't go back to normal. Powder was a girl she used to be, and while it's true that some semblance of her still resides somewhere, the person she has become now was the natural evolution of her character. Vi thinks that she can still go back. However, Silco states that Jinx is perfect as she is. She doesn't need to change herself in order to meet the expectations of the people around her. All Jinx needs to do is just be herself around Silco, because he's accepted everything that she is. The internal battle rages on within Jinx and Powder until it abruptly climaxes with Silco getting shot by her, and the last words he utters to his daughter is the final push she needed to cement Jinx as her own identity forever. "I never would have given them to you. Not for anything." It's these words that push Jinx over the edge as she sits down in her rightful spot, and the final act she does, taking aim at the council using the Hextech missile she developed and fires, is something irreversible, truly cementing her as the person she was always meant to be. Jinx, the daughter of Silco. She can't be Vi's sister anymore. Powder has changed. But so had Vi. When I finished the final episode, I was absolutely blown away by the enthralling story and intimate character drama that Arcane had managed to pull off. This series far beyond exceeded any expectations and reservations I had coming into it. Anyone looking in would have assumed the worst, that this was going to be a fan service story just like so many video game adaptations beforehand and only served to enjoy those who had played the games. But Arcane was anything but that. It told a truly beautiful story about about the tragedy of two sisters. It was a deeply personal and intimate character drama with so many moving parts to its narrative. Characters are treated like flawed human beings, good people can do bad things, and villains can sometimes do good. It's not all black and white. We live in a gray reality where there is no singular correct decision. Every character reflects and contemplates their own decisions that had led them to this point. And the show gives us multiple perspectives on how to handle the same situation. There are always positives and negatives to every choice you make. However, I think for me, the best aspect about Arcane was the emotional weight it carried for characters and their relationships with each other. Arcane may be a series with adrenaline-fueled action, spectacular animation, cinematic music, and epic audiovisual montages for the eye to see, but at its core, it's a story about the familial bond of two sisters and their tragic, inevitable separation. Hey everyone, this is the first non-anime video on my channel, and I really didn't expect it to be this long, but if anything deserved it, it was Arcane. Subscribe if you enjoyed the video, and comment down below if you want to see more non-anime related content in the future. Thanks for watching, it's been Kevin, and I'll see you all next time.